Yes, welcome to this workshop. My name is Torben Rasmussen. I'm the principal of an efterskole in Denmark, in Ryslinge. And those of you who are from abroad, you will visit our school tomorrow. I've been asked to be the practical part of this workshop. So you should not listen to me, but listen to Ulle Korsgaard, who will talk about togetherness and the dual school system. And what is important in this workshop, I think in all workshops, is that we, after Ulle Korsgaard's speech, we will have to talk about it. Because now we've listened for the whole morning, and now we have to talk. So that has to be part, I think you've been told too, Ulle, that this we have an hour and a half together, and part of it should be talking together in around the tables. So maybe we after you have started, Ulle, maybe we will split up so we are more or less equal amount of people at each table. But let us take that when we come to the debating and the talking part. So I, from here, I would like to welcome you. I know Jakob has done it down here, but I would like to welcome you, Ulle Korsgaard. You are one of those who know most of the free school systems in Denmark, and maybe therefore also know most about togetherness. We're looking forward to hear from you.
Thank you for the invitation to contribute to this fantastic conference. I am Professor Emeritus at Aarhus University, located in Copenhagen. That's complicated for Danes to figure that out. But before we were an independent university, but now we are part of Aarhus University. Before that, I was a student here at this school, and I was after that at a folk high school, a people's high school, as a teacher for 4 years, and headmaster for 17 years. So I was in the people's high school area for 21 years, and then I was 2 years back here to be principal at this place, and after that I went into the university system where I've been 21 years too. So so I know from my personal experience, you could say, this dual system we have in Denmark. Togetherness, and it was important that Nomi mentioned that when we talk about togetherness, we can talk about it on an individual level and on an institutional level and on a society level. And here we are on a society level. We can talk about other types of togetherness too, of course, but my presentation is on a society level. The main question, you could say, is what kind of togetherness have free schools what kind of togetherness to the society level should free schools have? If we take a short look at the history behind the free school movement, or especially this free school movement, which are connected, you could say, to this place here, and to the free schools, and to efterskole, and people's high school, then you have to be aware of that before we got constitution in Denmark in 1849 and before democracy, we had what we would call an estate society. It is often forgotten that in Denmark, the population was divided into four estates. The aristocrat was the first estate, the clergy, the priests and the bishops and so on, were the second estate, and then the bourgeois in the cities, some of the inhabitants in the cities belonged to the bourgeois, and then we had the peasants, we had the people, we had the commoners at the fourth estate. And there were different rules, different rights and obligations to each estate. The aristocrat, the nobility, has most rights and less obligations, and the peasants had a lot of obligations and few rights. For instance, the peasants were the only estate who had to jump as soldiers. And we have here a picture from the year 1600, so we go really very far back in a church. You can see there was this impression that it was a God-given structure. We had this structure from the Middle Ages up to 1849. And we had a lot of kings and we had a lot of wars during this period, but the stable structure was this estate structure. You can see that the nobility got a saw to defend or to go into war for the king. And then you have the king, all is given from above, from God. And then we have the priest, the clergyman, giving the Bible. And then we have the flag given to the peasant. So there was a clear division of labor, there was a clear division of rules, and so on. And so, yeah, one thing more. The concept people, the concept folk, was an underclass category. It belongs to the fourth estate. You can see that from a priest who wrote a book in 1869, as far back as we can go, the nobility and the clergy have themselves most respectfully declined the honor of being counted as of the people. So the nobility and the clergy, they didn't look at themselves as belonging to the people, because the people were the fourth estate. But when we got democracy, this under class category people took a turn around, you could say. Now it became a concept of sovereignty. Democracy is dependent on people's sovereignty. So this shift from being underclass category concept of sovereignty, here we have the concept of people's education or folkeoplysning. It was, I will come back to that, it was trying to clear for the commoners that they should not belong to the commoners anymore, they should belong to a people. You are of course allowed to Mark and raise questions and comments during my presentation. Here we have this man you have heard about, Brøndby. He is a key figure in building the Danish nation, and he has this ability to express complex questions in a very clear way. He became part of the Constitutional Assembly in 1848-49, and there he said, "The age of the estates is over, now it is time for the age of the people." So this shift from an estate society to a people society, that's the big shift in mentality and in the structure of the society. According to Brøndby, the age of the people and nation required education of the people for the nation building to begin. He implemented, as many will know, he implemented the idea of a new type of high school. The concept high school was known, but he implemented a new concept of high school, namely people's high school. And the most famous one of this people high school became Askov People's High School. It started in 1844 at Røden People's High School, but this high school was placed in Schleswig, and in 1864 Denmark lost Schleswig to Germany, so this high school now became part of Germany. So they took this high school and placed it on the other side of the border, and it was Askov High School. And it became a very famous high school, not only in Denmark, but also in other Nordic countries. They also built high school in Norway and Sweden and Finland. They established the first high school in Norway in 1864, and in Sweden in 1868, and in Finland in 1889. I will not go into detail. Some of you will know some of these people here, because they became very famous in the history of the Danish people high school. I will only mention one, and that's the man here, Poul la Cour. He built a windmill at Askov People's High School, and today Denmark is a leading country producing windmills, and of course it has to do with our tradition that they developed a lot of windmills after they have been at Askov People's High School learning about producing electricity out of windmills. My grandfather was a student at Askov High School in 1894 and 1896, and he learned to produce electricity because he learned from Poul la Cour from his windmill. And he was the first man at the island Mors, where I come from, who implemented electricity at a diary in the year 1900. So of course this, you could say this people's high school had half of the time, more or less, they worked with this concept people to change idea, change their mind, change the mentality from looking at themselves as peasants and commoners, and to persuade them that they belong to a people and they were equal with nobility and a priest and other person in the society. It was not, it has not been the case for hundreds of years. And the other half of the time at the people's high school, they learned how to produce electricity and how to farming and handcraft and so on. I think you have heard about the American political philosopher Francis Fukuyama, and he has contributed to a book which came last year, Building the Nation, NFS Country and Danish National Identity, which came published at a university in Canada. Francis Fukuyama has written an article here where he is saying that Grundtvig and his movement are of interest because it was a case of a strong national identity being formed from the bottom up rather than by a top-down state building using authoritarian methods. It is also the case of a strong national identity being defined in a way that was compatible compatible with democracy and a non-aggressive foreign policy. He is saying that there is a connection between state building and nation building. The state is something which has to do with a territory. We can, so to say, walk on a state because a state is a territory. The state controls the territory. Whereas the nation is something invisible. We have a phrase from Benedict Anderson, an anthropologist, Irish American anthropologist. In 1983, he published a book which has been used again and again, the title at least, because the title is Imagined Communities, and he is defining the nation as an imagined community, also as some forced in a fellowship. So the state is something physical, whereas the nation is invisible. And Francis Fukuyama is saying that state building is dependent on nation building. We are building states by law, first of all. But nation, how to build something which are invisible? We do that by stories, songs, films, and narratives and symbols and so a lot of people can and contributed to building nations, teachers, journalists, artists, novelists, and so on. And at this people's high school, they built this imagine to belong to an imagined community, to belong to a nation, and not to an estate society anymore. Yeah, when we talk about the free schools, then fashion cult is very important. He's a fascinating person, a very complicated person. Here I will only emphasize that he started a people's high school in Ryslinge, where you are, some are going tomorrow, in 1841, and a year after, in in 1852, he established a free school in Dalby. Some have this imagination that this is the first free school in Denmark. It is not correct. We have had free schools and private schools in many years before, but it is the first Grundtvigsk free school. We have, as I said, other types of private schools throughout our history, but this is a new type of free schools he established in 52. Here you can see a picture. It is from around 1900 of Dalby Free School, where Kold started in 1852. What was Christian Kold's pedagogical ideas? If you will put it into one word, I will say awakening. And it has to do with a new religious movement at the countryside, what we call de gudelige vækkelser, de gudelige forsamlinger. In the countryside, free schools in the Christian Kold model became the spearhead for a Kold's form of teaching was a pedagogic of awakening, just through with the battle cry of religious evangelism, awake, you must change your life. And this is bit by bit what common people did. They gradually acquired a new way of living that embraced folk and nation. They created new forms of social togetherness and solidarity, which were not based on birth, estate, occupation, or local affiliation. And as we increasingly adopted an identity molded around folk and nation, the ancient identity as an estate eroded. Again, this shift from commoners to people, that's the big shift in mentality and in structure. And this free school became what I here call a spearhead in this process. The state school was behind that, because at that time we still lived in, at least we have not really grown out of this state society, but this free school became spearhead in this process of moving out of this state society and belonging to a nation and to a people, Danish people. Then we got this Free School Act in 1855. This is a very important act in the history of free schools and after school and people's high school. This act meant that the Free School Act meant that compulsory school was abolished for commoners and replaced with compulsory education. So this shift from skole plikt to undervisningsplikt, that's the big shift. The peasant estate had won for itself the same right as the aristocracy and the clergy had always had, namely the opportunity to manage and finance their children's education themselves. Until this time, it was normal that the nobility and the clergy, they had their own house teacher. Grundtvig was a house teacher at the time, and Ingemann know, Kingo and Orson and other very famous Danish people, they started as teacher in a house in for nobility, a child of a nobility or a child of a priest. Grundtvig himself was sent to Jutland. He was born at Zealand. He was sent to Jutland, where he stayed for 8 years. Once a year, he was back to his parents, but he lived in a priest house where he got his education. Yeah. How was this, preschool act became part of our constitution in 1915. So all parents in Denmark have a right to take care of their own children, the upbringing and the education of their own children, and they can go together and form a school and take care of the education in that way. Not all were in favor of that. The Social Democratic Party were skeptical, but not so much in Denmark as in Norway and Sweden. In Norway and Sweden, private schools all private schools were more or less closed when the social democracy came into power. It was not the case in Denmark, and we can see a leading social democrat, Baldia, he became Minister of Education in the 30s. After the Social Democrat took power with the Social Liberal Party in 1992, the Social Democratic Minister for Education, Frederik Borbjerg, declared that he was in favor of communal state school, but, and that's important, but that he had no desire to see a state monopoly in schools. There had to be space for free schools alongside state schools. I don't want a stiff, uniform national state school. I want there to be room for individuality, for new movement. He declared that in the parliament in 1930. And that's quite exceptional. Because, as I said, in Norway and Sweden, the Social Democratic Party was not in favor of private schools or free schools. They have changed their mind the last 10, 20 years in Norway and Sweden. But for many years, there was no private schools, no free schools in Norway and Sweden. In Denmark, we kept this tradition. And thanks, you could say, to the Social Democratic, and especially to Bolivia. So Grundtvigians has to admire him. In the 30s, we, you know, the history, Hitler came into power in 1933 in Germany, and some Danes, also in the People's High School, were looking at him as really something, because he seems to be able to get out of chaos, and one leading figure, especially in gymnastic woman, Nils Buch, at the other site here in Ollerup. Mm-hmm. He started this high school, gymnastic high school in 1920. He started really here in 1914 as a teacher at this people's high school that were here before it became a teacher training college. So he started here in Nils Buch, but built his own school at the other site, a very big one. You should go there and take a look, it is quite impressive. And he was a very impressive man, but he had sympathy for Hitler and the Nazi regime. And he told, for instance, one time in 1933, if I was 20 years younger, then I would do the same thing as Hitler had done in Germany. So some were asking Borgia, should we still give him state support? He is in favor of a system which are not democratic, is in favor of Nazism. Should we still give him state support? And then Borgia, he declared also in the parliament, according to Borgia, his book's opinions were no concern of the state. A man has the right to be an anarchist and to demand the abolition of the state as long as he does not make use of illegal means to carry out his demands to that effect. If Nils Buch himself put himself at the head of his followers, you see his followers here, his followers, and storm Copenhagen, well, then the state has to take action, but not before. It is really something from a social democrat to say that we should not take away his state support. He can have his opinion, as he can be an anarchist, he can be a Nazist. So that's okay as long as he is not taking action, that he go from ideas to action and storm Copenhagen, as they say. Yeah. A history which not told very often, but I think it is necessary also to remind us that in the 1930s, after we got half of the Schleswig back with a referendum in 1920, and they were allowed to establish public schools and of course also free schools, and they did that. But then in the 1930s, most of these schools were Nazified, you could say. Free schools and the German part of the public schools. More or less all of them were Nazified. And so they were closed after the Second World War, and teachers were examined if they were if they would be loyalty to the Danish state, because they had not been that during this period where they were Nazified. So it was not, the decision was after the Second World War that the German minority, they were not allowed anymore to establish public schools as German schools. But the free school tradition was so strong, so they could still continue to establish free school. And of course, on another basis, on another ideology, and this ideology they were influenced by during the Nazi regime. So that this free school tradition has been, you could say, supported very strongly. I mentioned Bolgia, and I will finish this part, mention Bert Horter. He became Minister of Education in 1982, and he gave a speech at sporting free schools in 1983, where he was saying, now the caretaker, and he used this concept about himself, now the caretaker is going to speak. For my right to say anything here is a par with the caretakers. I do not manage this school, you do. So he emphasized very strongly that even if he is Minister of Education, I have nothing to say here. It is you who decide at the school. So, as I have mentioned, this tradition in Denmark for free schools is exceptional, strong, and has been supported strongly by, so to say, all political parties until a few years ago. I give this story to show you the shift we will turn into this shift and see what has changed in relation to this tradition and this support by the political system, by this free school act and free school system. So are there questions or comments before I move into the our present situation? So you are very welcome. You can ask in Danish and then you can do it in English as you want, as you like.
Ove,
yeah.
Another example of the policy in the past, I think, could be the creation of another free school, Lille Skolen.
Yeah.
They were created in the 60s or 70s,
yeah.
And actually they were not democratic in their point of view. Were there any politicians by that time who said, we cannot allow a school system like that, because they believed in Marx, some of them.
Mm. Yeah.
Were there any politicians who said by that time, they should not be allowed in the Danish society?
No, on the opposite, because we have a strong case we call indoctrineringsdebatten, or say indoctrination debate, in the beginning of the 80s. I think it was just in the beginning of the 80s, because there was a concern about indoctrination by very left wing. Position in the public school, and it came up in the parliament, and there were a very, very strong debate about indoctrination. And it was said again and again, it is not allowed to indoctrinate in the public school. If you want to indoctrinate, you can go to the free school. we had a Minister of Education at that time, Tove Nielsen. She was saying that from the parliament. You are not allowed to indoctrinate in the public school, you can go to the free school. And also the from the Conservative Party, the spoke woman from the party, also emphasized the same point. So at that time, it was seen, okay, there is a free space to establish school on what kind of opinion you want and what kind of indoctrination you want to try to follow or implement. Yeah, so so it stressed this, what I stressed, that there was this very strong support at free school was another thing, yeah.
How was the state funding back then? Was it at the same level as it is today? The state funding of the school form?
Yeah, they were more or less the same.
More or less the same, so they had not quite changed anything.
No, it was not a question of money.
No. Because you have Tvindloven, actually, but that's...
Yeah, Tvindloven, yeah, that's... I'm not going into Tvindloven.
No.
But to show that today we have a lot of different free schools and private schools and different organizations. So what here we are talking about let me see. And we could take it from the above. We have the German schools and the language association with 15 schools and 1,400 pupils. And then we have association for private gymnasiums with 31 schools. And then we have the Danish free school associations from 1886. And this is tradition who belong to this place, you could say, and to the free school and to the school. The free school associations with 340 schools and about 47,000 pupils. Of these, about 60 schools with 10,000 pupils are known as Lilleskoler or small schools. It was the school you mentioned, that they have now been part of this, they hadn't the own organization before, but now they are more or less a part of the Danish Free School Association. And this, they were established in the 60s and 70s and had a lot of attention at that time. And then we have Denmark's private school association from 1891 with 130 schools and about 56,000 pupils. So you can, if you compare, that's the two, and there is a lot of schools here. There is less schools here, but there is more pupils in the private school. So that what we call the private school are much larger than the free school association and the schools beyond. Then we have 22 Catholic schools, and then we have the Association for Christian Free Schools with about 35 schools and about 7,500 pupils. So there is a lot of variety in the field of free schools, private schools. They all belong to the same act, to the same law, but have different historical backgrounds and different ideology. Let me see.
What about the Muslim free
schools?
Where do you have them?
The Muslims, yeah. They should be...
No, the Danish free schools.
They are part here.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
No, 27.
27, yeah. I don't know what... I have had them but they have been lost. Yeah, 27 Muslims.
And also the Rudolf Steiner schools.
Rudolf Steiner, yeah.
I'm part of them.
Yeah, and one of them is a Muslim preschool at Nørrebro, and according to a study from the university I belong to,
show that Muslim students feel they are different in elementary school because of the faith. Therefore, take several Muslim parents, their children, out of public schools and into a free school or private school. Of course, there is different reasons by showing a private school and a free school from Muslim. But I think that's one of the leading motivation the choose of a free school or a private school. Yes. This new type of schools, this, we call them Muslim schools. They are that it is an umbrella because they are different. There are different type of Muslim schools, but it is fair to say that this new type of school has caused a lot of attention in the Danish public and in the Danish political system. The Free School Act has been changed a number of times the last 20 years. And not all of the change has to do with Muslim schools, but most of them have. In 2002 and 2005, free schools were giving an update clause determining what form of social community school were to promote. To say it in another word, for the first time, see, democracy was became part of the Free School Act. It became part of the public school in 1976, and in 2002 and 2005, it became part of the Free School Act too. And so yeah, you can see what was written, not only democracy, but also human rights and respect for equality between sexes. That's the main, that's the key words in this text. So, but for half a year ago, there was a television program showing something from Aarhus, from a mosque in Aarhus, where there was some was interviews which really got a lot of attention because it was so strange to hear that in Denmark, that the political system, they felt they had to act. So just now, this month, there will be new rules in the Free School Act, in the Folkeoplysningsloven, and in the church, state regulation of the church, and so on. And this is because of this television program from Aarhus. And the debate is about this: what government want to implement in the Free School Act. Because now they want to be sure that the democratic education have an effect, so you can measure if the pupils have become more democratic. Mm-hmm. And we are some, which are saying we are, of course, in favor of democracy and also democratic education, about democracy. but it is really a break with the free school tradition if you make state inspection, where you try to see if they are democratic in the head. That's really the discussion now. I think this will be implemented, and perhaps it is decided now, I'm not sure, but.
Could that not also be seen as brainwashing? The brainwashing in the, you know, in the sense to be supportive of democracy, but democracy is not necessarily the only possible way to rule a country. And if you have a democratic mind, then you're capable to debate the possibilities. So if schools are only teaching to promote democratic character, they're also not training their students to be truly democratic in their decision of how they want to lead a school or how they want to lead the country eventually.
Yeah, I'm not sure I get the point in your question and all your remark.
I think the point is that it's not very democratic to ask, to tell people to be democratic.
Yeah, and also that we were just talking about brainwashing in schools and policing that and making sure that there's no brainwashing.
Yeah.
Could this also be, if we're going to inspect and check, you know, are people thinking democratically, that's also encouraging brainwashing.
Yeah. That's really an important question to bring up. Because in 2002, I was in favor of the Free School Act also should refer to democracy, like the public school. But some of my friends in the free school, they were against that on this reason you are mentioning, that it is an ideology, and you should be able to establish a free school on a non-democratic. I'm not in favor of that, but you're not the only one. Some in the free school are arguing like you do. We can have a discussion about this topic, but because it raised the question, what kind of togetherness should free school have to the state?
And now also when we're keeping globalization in that discussion, there's many different types of politics in the world. So we have to have a relationship to the state in the school system, but we also have to have knowledge of the other systems.
Yeah. You could say it is the state who finance most of them. The question is, should we be so free that we say to the state, you have to pay us, but we will establish the school on a non-democratic basis?
That was what I wanted to say, that in all fairness, you could say that it is the state who finances the schools, so that not much logic in financing something that wants to undermine you.
But it was the question with Borgia, if you remember Borgia.
I know. But for him, and I can see the shift, that for him it was as long as you kept it as an idea and did not act upon it. Now we are saying we don't even want the idea.
Exactly.
But you could say this about the equality between genders, that it might actually be acted upon as some tools. So there are so it's a very difficult
It is
debate.
Really difficult. Should
we let start the discussion just in a minute in smaller groups and then we can go?
Yeah.
So if you, well, could we take this? I think it's a very good discussion to have.
Yeah,
in a small
yeah,
groups.
Yeah, mm-hmm. let's break up in small groups and you organize it.
No, I think some of you are eager to say something now. And I think it's important to sit together with some people you do not know too much, but maybe you are actually split up in different schools in different countries. No?
Are we getting back to this? Because I have a question for some of the stuff.
I think we should collect it in the end. So I think we should do that. Would that be a way
to do it? That's fine, yeah.
So we have four tables here. And one question is, maybe it's not... Well, you brought togetherness up in the end,
yeah.
But maybe we are more eager to discuss how free can a dual system be when both schools are supported from the state.
Mm.
That is actually where we end now. How free can a state be or a dual school system be when both schools are supported by states? Of course, if one school is not supported by a state,
yeah.
You just have to obey the law. And that's it. But can you actually have a school who's trying to
thrive or something?
Exactly.
Yeah, on like the state
I think that could be one discussion here. The other one could be now we're talking about motivation and togetherness. What role has our school system played in the history? I think Who said that in the beginning, that in Denmark togetherness was a national thing? Was that she? Togetherness was a natural thing, and abroad they don't know actually the word moralness. I'm not sure that is the objective truth, but it's a statement. And we could also discuss what role has the free school system played, and what is more important, what role will the free school system play in the future when it comes to togetherness? Because you could actually divide it into, well, the politicians today would say, one part would say it's very important, the other part would say no. Actually, the free school, they can exclude people, so they have their togetherness is limited. So could we take, or maybe there's a third discussion as well?
Can I add something, yes? Because I also think part of the discussion, it could be interesting to hear something about how can we as free schools taking the leadership or being to show our values without denying. Sometimes it's like we are cutting what we are sitting on, because we are not using the democracy way of just denying, say, okay, people can mean whatever they want to, but at the same time, maybe they can't. Do you follow?
Mm-hmm. They can mean whatever they want, as long as they mean what we
want them.
What the state wants them.
And if they don't, then we deny it.
Yeah.
And is that the only way to go?
Let's take. We have to finish here 4:15. Then there is a break. Let's take a group discussion until half,
yes.
And then we'll get together and some questions can be asked while you're here.
Could you say one or two sentences about the social composition of free schools? Because for me that's kind of a missing piece. Are the free schools more middle class than the state schools? Is there a difference in the social composition of the student body between free schools and... There's not, okay. I was wondering about this because in Germany the free schools are, the parents are wealthier than at
free schools. They are very different, so there's something for
it. They made a socio-economic
measurement
a few years ago, and it showed it was equal.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, you can say that from the historical point of view, this here is belonging to the countryside.
Mm.
And this here is belonging to the cities. That today it is more complex, but still it is for sure that the free school, as you say, has most of the school at the countryside, and the private school early school in the cities.
Yeah, but I think you could also say maybe that some families actually can't afford to send their children, for instance, to after school. It can be a, there can be an economic limitation.
Yeah.
So I think there will be a little sort of tendency towards a little bit more wealthy people sending their kids to after school.
School.
Yeah, there must be.
It also depends on how you define wealth, because there's also like the social network and the academic skills and stuff that you cannot measure in that.
Yeah, of course. Mm.
And for me, it's not clear the difference between private school and free schools.
No. They belong to the same act, the same law.
But when do you use the word private and when do you use the word free?
The only Danes know that.
Not all Danes know.
You have to be, you could call all of them private schools. But it sounds not right in the Danish language. Therefore, the concept free school is so strong a word in the Danish tradition that it is difficult for people belonging to the free school tradition to use the word private school, because they are something else. They are from the cities, and they are more like, perhaps they are, they grow up out of bourgeois, you could say.
Yeah, couldn't you get close to it by saying that the private schools actually have the same subject as the folk school, as the public school, but the free schools are often formed on the basis of sort of they want to do something else. So that's, isn't that more or less the way?
So free schools are what the English we would call alternative schools?
Yeah, like they sort of, often they are sort of formed on the basis that they want to sort of do a little bit alternative things, they want to think differently about forming schools, not always completely, but...
But the tricky business is probably founded in one and not necessarily the private.
The private school, they do not live in the course of Columbia.
No, it's just a school, but it's private.
They have the head of two years in Columbia.
You did it, but it happened necessary.
Okay.
So, everybody stand up and stretch out.
Canadian Charles Taylor. According to him, there is a need for common identity in a democratic state. But what does that mean, common identity? What kind of togetherness should free schools strive for in a democratic state? My last slide is, I think that free schools would benefit from promoting the idea of citizenship education, citizenship. Yeah, the democratic citizenship has today's answer to togetherness. Free schools should contribute to a common political identity by implementing citizenship education. I think that would be a very important signal to the public sphere, and also to the political system, that we have citizenship, citizenship education, because our pupils, they have to be citizens in Denmark. To be citizens in Denmark. So the concept citizens, I mean, I think that you can be a citizen with a different culture, or your own culture, or your own religion, and your own ethnicity, and your own sexual orientation. But we need an umbrella to saying that we are all citizens in Denmark. So therefore, my answer would be implement citizenship education at the free school. Then I think that political system will slow down on trying to bind the system more and more. Yeah.